is extremely important. And that's where my worry is with modeling, that even us, you know, we struggle at Bloomberg to, you know, do predictive analysis, but even after that event has happened, we fail to realize within the model the ripple effect of such an event. So that, I think, is also extremely important thing to realize and factor in.
Just one comment from my side. You are absolutely right, whatever you said. But there is, as you might be aware, that there is a different genre of models. This is basically univariate model. It has certain advantages and certain disadvantages. The kind of effect which you are talking about, there are different kind of models, which is, well, VAR could be one of them, then there are many other models where that particular problem can be tackled. So it depends on the problem, you can select the model. It's not the other way around. This is not that kind of model. Yeah. The problem which you have told.
A closer example on this would be your grid failure.
Yeah.
If 30th of July happens, right, then does the model in the future is able to take the ripple effect repercussions of that 30th July event in the future is an important thing. Because the regulators will change system planning issues, the regulators will change tariffs, there will be energy efficiency measures that will be taken.
No doubt.
So the historical data is not able to capture all that.
I'm sure like more and more data they can do event study kind of.
Yeah, event study is another
one.
Yes.
Provided they have some big data set.
There will be more kind of a CGI modeling and things like that. There you will be able to do that.
The thing is that, as I mentioned, the kind of issues which you are raising, I think it more of the policy environment, changing the policy environment and how that affects the consistency of your estimates on the model. For instance, there is a new discussion taking place with respect to the structural time series modeling, where even the estimate of the coefficient is not static. It's not a point estimate, but it varies. So I think it's more of the policy perspective which is coming in your argument that, okay, what kind of the ripple effect? But that is one natural catastrophe, but then also from the policy perspective, it's very different. We cannot deny the fact that the policy environment do influence the business environment and then the strategic interventions. Okay. So there are new models which are coming up.
Okay. And also it depends on the quantity you are forecasting, like price, electricity, these are continuous.
Yeah.
Suppose you want to forecast, say, volume. So sometimes volume will be 0, sometimes volume will be 10,000. Such cases, time series is not being used.
Right.
Probably in those cases, you can use model like zero inflated Poisson model. Like zero inflated because zero is like for Poisson model, mean and variance, they should be equal. But in realistic, when you have mode of zero, basically your Poisson model becomes biased towards zero. So to take care of that, we have developed a zero inflated Poisson model. So I think it's the quantity which you are forecasting. Like models should be based on the quantity which you are providing. There, like for price or electricity, is the time series which may work, but for say volume production, time series may not work.
Ma'am, you wanted to add?
Yeah. First of all, I would like to congratulate you all on having done this, and I'm sure it can take into account implications and things. But I would just like to know that does it take into account the sudden effect of a say tariff increase? Last year we increased tariff, the energy demand reduced rather than increasing. So how do you take that into account? You know, there was a 0% increase in energy in 1 year because the tariff increased maybe. So people stopped or they started conserving energy. So how does this model factor that into account? For example, like again, tariffs will increase. So, would your model be able to predict such a thing?
You want me to answer?
Can I just add something to what you said? The tariff increase which you said doesn't increase the energy. But my experience in one of the district was in company that was in Odisha during AES time. The tariff increase has increased the T&T losses.
That
increase in energy. What happens
is people will start. People may start stealing more. But it very clearly observed that the energy demand also did not increase in this year. Ma'am, so I was just trying to find out whether that
if I answer your question, if I explain it,
as you said that effect of tariff on the demand, that one simplest way is to calculate the price elasticity of demand. That is a multivariate case. In a regression analysis, one can do this. And as you said that the price has no effect, its statistical mean is that the elasticity is statistically insignificant. So it means that although there is an increase in price, but the customer's response to manage their load is people can afford that even with that higher price. So that is one of the impression. But as there are two ways to answer your question, this actually without taking into consideration the price issue, since a univariate model, so if there is any impact on price on demand, that, as I told, the footprint will be there in the data itself. So in univariate model, without considering whether there is a tariff change or not, we can forecast, number one. Now if you really want to see the specific effect of tariff on demand, then I think regression model is one of the model where you can calculate the price elasticity of demand so that the responsiveness of the increase of price on demand can be calculated.
No, usually what I meant was that you know, we take a growth rate of say 6% or 7% in Delhi. But if you see the time series or you see past trends, but when you see the effect of tariff this year, it has not grown by 6%, it has been 0%. So is that factored in when you forecast? Because if you will see the past trends, then it will not be factored in.
Let me just add, since I come from economics background,
yeah,
sure. I already answered partly the question. Thing is, see, this kind of model will not be able to take care of what specific issue you are raising. That requires a cognitive, the other technology, CFL or LEDs may be available, and also the income, which is there. So income impact is showing higher increase in demand, but the price is neutralizing that. So effectively, finally you see the demand has not changed very much. So that cannot be done, as far as I know, from this model. That has to be done separately with the regression model, which will possibly have monthly or yearly or maybe 6 monthly data. That is the best approach. This is more for short, very, very short term forecasting. This process.
Thank you.
Just an
academic question from this group. You have this, you have stated from 2007 to the data, and suppose you have the projection, you have the actual data. Can we know from the deviation? What can be the causes, or if we list down the causes, what is the contribution of those causes for you?
For this, I think regression analysis will be more useful for that.
What I want to say, suppose I ask you to look at the data for March 2007, there is a deviation. Can we kind of analyze and see what can be the factor if you give the list of the factor? Maybe what is what we need to tell.
Thank you everybody for a very good time.
Thank you everybody. Now our second topic for student group 2 for today is modeling volatility and forecasting daily crude oil price traded in WTI by Ernest Arima, Vidash Model. Right, sure.
loss leads to an increase in the marginal production cost, which has a negative impact on the output. This in turn also results in a negative impact on the employment. Net struggle is a wealth transfer effect which mostly affects countries like India, who import to 70% of their oil requirements from abroad. So the wealth transfer effect indicates a transfer of wealth from oil importing countries to the oil exporting countries, and hence deteriorating the terms of trade for the oil importing countries. The next is the real balance effect, in which an increase in oil price could lead to an increase in the money demand. The monetary authorities fail to provide money supply in order to cater to the growing money demand, and hence there will be a rise in the interest rate in the economy, which will retard the economic growth. Next is the inflation effect, which we all know that an increase in the oil price leads to inflation in the economy. Then there is a sector adjustment effect, which is like increase in oil prices shifts the production cost from one sector to the other, and hence there is such a sector adjustment which is taking place. And the last is the unexpected effects, focusing on the uncertainty over the oil prices. Hence, the volatility of the oil prices needs to be moderate, and that's what we are doing in this presentation. The daily crude oil prices shows four properties. One is non-stationarity, as explained by Professor Sajjan Kaur sir. It is the mean and variance, which is time variant. The seasonality, time varying volatility, and regime switching properties. Hence, the volatility, knowing the volatility and forecasting it will help the producers and industrial consumers who faces a lot of risk with respect to these two components. We will use univariate models for this case study, and we'll use the historical data of WTI crude oil prices for the modeling. The objective of the study is to forecast day ahead WTI crude oil prices using a hybrid model of MS-IMA and EGARCH. EGARCH is the exponential generalized autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity. Here we take two data spans in order to understand the forecasting. One data span is from December 2007, and the next is the recent one, which is February 2012 and till February 2013. The reason for choosing two data span is the first one is during the period of the third oil price shock, which happened from 2003 to 2008, where we might see that there are certain external factors due to which the price of crude oil had been very volatile, and it had gone from $20 per barrel to almost $100 per barrel. Hence, we are trying to model the data during this period and try to forecast it and see the kind of percentage error. So, an idea that will give a very good idea of how good our modeling is, and we'll use the same model to model the data for the very recent data sets, which is in 2012. This shows this a graphical representation of the two data sets. Now we look at the modeling part of it, continued by Naresh Gupta.
Thank you, Sunil. So we can see here some IMA models. And we follow the box Jenkins model. There are four steps. One is identification. Second one is estimation. Third is diagnostic testing. And fourth one is forecasting. So in identification, we need to know the series is stationary or non-stationary. We need to conduct the ADF test. And ADF test we conduct and we found the results. Let's start here. And we conclude that the series is non-stationary. So in order to make the series stationary, we differentiate it, and we found that two different variables, AR2, SMA5 and SMA10. So SMA10, when we estimated, SMA10 found it insignificant variable, and AR2 and SMA5 is significant variable. After that, we draw this polygraph of the statistics, and we found that we have reached the whole wide this process because all the probability are going statistically significant. And then we forecast the in sample forecasting, and we find that there are 0.9% error in the model. Then we can say this model is good for forecasting with 0.9% error. After this, we plot the residuals and we found that there are two regions. One is high volatility region and another one is low volatility region. And we can see that the region, there could be an artifact. In order to capture this artifact, we need to conduct the ER test. And this ER test can handle this kind of high volatility and low volatility region. So ER effect will be
thank you, Naresh. So now we'll see, before going for the EGARCH model, what are the main problems with the RIMA modeling because of which we go for the volatility models. Now the oil price changes are stationary, but they are of a volatile series. The univariate RIMA modeling, it will predict the conditional mean, but it will assume that the residual variance is constant over time instead of changing. Also, the series will exhibit high variability and suggest that the conclusion or the forecast, which is based on the ordinary least square method, is likely to be inaccurate, because of which a correction is required to reduce this volatility or the so-called risk and go for the retrostochastic volatility models. Now, the time value volatility and the retrostochasticity modeling, and why do we go for this? This model, instead of correcting the problem and re-estimating the conditional mean, the ARCH and the GARCH models will rather address the issue of the retrostochasticity by modeling the retrostochastic variance with changes over time rather than remaining constant. The ARCH models are employed commonly in modeling financial time series that exhibit time value volatility clustering, that periods of swings followed by periods of relative calmness. Specifically, when we take the EGARCH model, there are no restrictions of non-negativity which is required to be imposed for the estimation as opposed to when we go only for the GARCH model. Now, as you can see, the next graph is the period of high volatility, the international crude oil prices. International crude oil prices. So from 4th March 2008 to 4th November 2008, there was a period of high volatility because of which there was a lot of fluctuation. Coming specifically to the EGARCH model, this is the equation of the EGARCH model, which signifies the variance is the size effect given by lambda, the sine effect given by gamma, and finally the persistence effect given by delta. So how we have, and the characteristics of this model, as you can see, the left hand side of the equation is of the nature log of HT. Which will mean that the variance itself will be positive irrespective of whether the coefficients are positive or not. And as opposed to the GARCH model, as I've already mentioned, the restrictions of non-negativity will not be there. And also a very interesting observation by the researchers is that the negative shocks, this thing will increase the volatility much more than the positive shocks. So now we'll see how we have used this model for our study. We have initially done a test of the ARCH effect, that's the heteroscedasticity test, which shows that all the variables are significant. So that means there is a now we have estimated the various parameters for the size effect, the sine effect and the persistence effect, and we can see that the size effect and the persistence effect are quite significant. We will see the interpretation in the next slide, and the sine effect is insignificant, which would mean that in case of the size effect, that it indicates that the shock to the crude oil prices has a greater impact on volatility irrespective of the direction of shock. We can see that the sine effect is insignificant, which indicates that the presence of symmetric effect. It is showing symmetry, that is the negative shocks and positive shocks give rise to similar volatility of prices and maybe no difference. In case of the persistence effect, once again it is significant, which will mean that the coefficient is small and indicates that the shocks to volatility are only transitory effects. And we have also done a diagnostic test which suggests that the residual series are changed from autocorrelation and others. Now, after estimating these parameters, once again we have gone for the EGARCH test by removing the time varying volatility, and we have done the test for all the 5 lines, once again 1, 5, 10 and 20, which again shows that they are insignificant, which means that the ARCH effect is now finally removed. So, and then we have also gone for the forecasting. We have studied the various parameters, which is root mean square error, the mean percentage absolute error, and we have finally concluded that in this case, as we can see, we have done a comparative study of both the ARIMA and the ARIMA EGARCH model, and we have seen that in case of the ARIMA EGARCH model, in this hybrid model, it gives marginally higher forecast error, as we can see here, that is 0.973 is higher than 0.961, and this is due to the incorporation of time varying volatility in the analysis. However, the mean absolute percentage error in both the cases data of modeling, we have modeled our daily oil price for the data span again between 2012 and 2013. This will be again explained by Sunil.
Thank you. Thanks, Rajma. So now coming to the second data set, we do the same kind of ACF and PACF analysis, and we find that there are two variables, which is auto, this one is auto reversal of order one, and one another is moving average of a lag five, which are significant in this model. And the data, which is 1 year back data, it has both trend and seasonal component to it. So in order to convert it into a stationary series, we had to de-trend it and de-seasonalize it. And we also checked the residual, whether there is a arch effect present, and we did arch LM test in order to find that out. And we found that the arch effect is not present in the residual series. And in the next slide, it shows the forecasting using this particular model. So we have done forecasting for 5 days in February, and we have done the static forecasting, which is the in-sample forecasting, and out-of-sample forecasting, which is for the future, which is a dynamic forecasting. And the results of both of them are shown in the slide over here. As you can see, the mean absolute percentage error, which is MAP, is around 1.1 for the in-sample forecasting, and for the future, it is 2.4. This is quite good for analysis of WPI crude prices, which is kind of sensitive for many businesses. So we conclude that in both the cases, the models exhibit superior performances, and though GARCH effect is present in the first data set, it is not present in the second data set, which is obvious because the first data set was taken during a highly volatile period and the second data set was not that comparatively volatile. And models of both, modeling periods of both high volatility and low volatility results in precise prediction parameters. So what are the impacts of this study? This study has an impact, important impact on managers of the OMCs and analytical companies, and also for certain PSUs who actually import oil from outside, and sometimes there is a delay between the time the tender is booked and the time the order is received, and hence a short-term forecasting of say 5 to 7 days will give a better planning to these kind of PSUs. And the study can be further advanced using more GARCH family of models like C-GARCH, etc. And these are a few of the references which we have used for this analysis. So we can discuss on the slide.
I would like to ask a question slightly different from oil. And discounting this year better than other things, which has again gone haywire. Now what has happened? Why it has happened? Because first we have to see the demand, then in the demand we have to see the supply. In the supply, what we have to see, what is the availability of the coal or availability of the fuel and other things, many other factors, many combinations and combinations come into picture. Then comes the unscheduled interchange, which was mainly adopted by the government to maintain a discipline in the grid, but that has become a game in this market. Can your team or can work something so that there is a proper forecast of merchant tariff in the future, which can lead to give some authenticity to the valuation of the power projects or the power assets which are coming up, so that investors can have some comfort when they come and invest in some power projects that are going to come up in the future.
Sir,
so,
like in the last industry day which we had, we had presented the topics on regression. So there was a topic on electricity load modeling. So we had used a lot of variables like the GDP of the country and per capita income and all those things. And we have found the elasticity component of it, like the income elasticity of demand, like how much if the per capita income increases, how much is the load per capita is increasing in that respect. And we had actually found a statistical relationship. So maybe that kind of study can help in.
That is not his question.
Sorry. Yeah, I love. See, basically, what we are expecting is the price forecast. what is going to be the price of electricity in future. All the models what we have discussed today, one is your load forecasting, other is your oil forecasting, that is fuel price forecasting. Because when we say demand supply ratio, it is going to have the impact on the prices. So most important is you need to forecast the demand, for which you will also need the weather and other parameters. Then you will forecast your supply. For supply, you need to know the generation, what is going to be the generation. And for generation forecast, you need to know the installed capacity and what is going to be the upcoming power projects and what is the availability of power.
And how much has been tied up in long?
Correct. Your bilateral agreements, all those things will come into play. So this whole, it is not just one model which will be able to do it. You have to combine all this forecasting. You will have various modules. You will have a forecasting like the oil price forecast. So it will have a fuel price forecast, fuel price, coal prices. So same way you will have your demand forecast, and finally you will be able to build up a complete solution which will be able to give you the price.
Is it possible to build something?
If I answer this question, sir. Actually, the kind of problem which you are going to address, there is an entire different genre of models which can be taken care of, which is called the applied general equilibrium models. These are entirely different from these time series models, where exactly as you told that it is a major issues. One is supply side, one is demand side, then there are government policies, then there are tariff issues, then the availability of the coal. So many more endogenous factors actually ultimately come up with the pricing of the merchant power. So this kind of model, they are not suitable to address those kind of issues. However, as I told, the applied general equilibrium kind of model, which is a large macro model, which can taken care of to address the issue which you are highlighting.
Can a study be made, because we are looking at something, some authentic data, can a study be made by
India? It can be done, but well, first of all, this is not my area which I am working, but there are people who can work in the optimization and the applied general equilibrium models. You can look at this. I can say that there is one organization which is IRADE, integrated, the Kirit Parikh and Jyoti Parikh's organization, who are our teachers, my guide also. So they are the right person to handle this kind of issue. The office is in Delhi itself. So they are generally specialized on this applied general equilibrium kind of model, which can help to address the issue which you are raising.
I just wanted to quickly add what you said. When you're looking at the supply side equation, obviously you have to look at the demand and supply and do equilibrium analysis and predict the pricing. But when you're looking at the supply side equation, in the medium term, which is let's say next 2 to 5 years or something like that, essentially you have a pipeline of projects that you can get. So you can, you know, go to the CE and ask the number of projects that might be big and the cost of predict your cost of conversion. But in the long term, you don't have a pipeline. So essentially what we guys do in house is we look at the cost of predictive cost of energy generation for those, for all kinds of energy generation technologies after 5 to 10 years. And essentially the trajectory they would fall. So you know, if you bet that coal will increasingly become costlier, then you have to bet that cost of coal generation will also become costlier. And essentially, so if the demand is not exploding, then you know, coal generation will probably get starting replaced by, you know, if a large hydro is possible, then large hydro. If not, then larger distribution generation on renewable energy side. Renewable energy obviously becomes costlier day by day. So essentially then it's not about the number of projects that is being built in the short term or medium term, but about the cost of our generation itself from the supply source.
I think just one more thing when I talked about demand here. Here the demand can be created artificially also, because if the tariff goes up, people will prefer to go for load setting and reduce the demand. So people can prefer to live in darkness than giving high tariff. So all these permutations and combinations and getting a realistic figure on merchant tariff, which has become a big topic of discussions now, that's why I wanted to know. So I take your point, so I think we will...
They are the right person,
yeah,
honestly.
Yeah.
But the sensitivity of the price with demand, as I told, it is generally captured by the price elasticity of demand.
Yeah.
So that is if you the figure can give us that what is the consumer responsiveness due to the fluctuation of the price. But it is not that, whatever the questions which you have asked, it is a more complex problem. It is not the demand only, not the supply only, and as he has mentioned that there are inter-fuel substitution possibilities depending upon the cost of power at the bus bar. Sometimes it may happen that, it might happen that there is a heavy tax on the coal-fired power plants. So there is a natural tendency to shift to the gas-based power plant provided gas is available. So these are all futuristic scenarios where, as I told, that a general equilibrium model can develop those kind of scenarios and finally come up with actually your objective, which is the kind of tariff. But I think they are the, you know, they are the specialists in this area, so okay. Maybe you can.
In fact, one thing we do, we also do emissions tracking for asking for new emission studies. And one thing we do there on the demand side is he's saying is we adjust the demand based on something called validation paper. So essentially, if we think, you know, the demand will not be met by supply in terms of potential pricing of the supply, then we adjust the demand downwards based on the willingness to pay kind of a module within.
Hello. I was editing the technical planning analysis industry. This is the topic of oil. Before I give my comments, let me congratulate the students, the teachers for introducing the models, and they have applied the model to a specific issue. As far as application is concerned, it's okay. But what we very sure about the conceptual clarity and the objectives that you set out to think and the results that you want to gain. Here, suppose you are thinking what the points of. You must remember that it's a kind of a ex post factor impact. It's not ever exactly. When you say oil sir, actually after it has happened, you say it's oil sir. Because look at the process, you have chosen the period 2007, the process started in 2004. Nobody spoke there is soft. Started gradually, lighting up. You know, even when the oil price climbs, it's a volatile. You know, even testing hydro oil, in a rising case could be a higher volatility than a falling case. So all this conceptual knowledge is very much required, you know, to really get an accurate result. So 2007, obviously in this period, when the build-up was sad. And in 2008, July, it went on. So then the super sun, because 147 in a very short span of 1 year was not really predictive. So, if you look at any literature in oil particularly, the forecast is one of telling the users that look, you avoid this, you know, sharp shocks or immediate kind of spikes, they are okay. But if you neglect those things and look at kind of a short term, medium term, you know, the violence probably this is what is and what will if super forecast is concerned. So therefore if you are going for this kind of very, very short term, even short term deficit in the oil is not a day or month, it's 1 year. And in medium term could go 10 years. I was surprised. So therefore, anyway, how we call it a medium term plan. But when I was reading the oil literature, they say it's not 10 years. And long term is 20 years and beyond, because all the plant activity, the refinery, the restoration, any project to pick up from concept to commercialization is not less than 15 years. So, real long-term planning is a little different than other sectors. So, therefore, this is okay for application of the model, this is quite fine. We have gone into it. But if we are going to have the impact of volatility on the user side, probably we should go for a multivariate analysis, take this 1 year period. And then within 1 year period, this invariant probably may not work because there are so many factors working. So you pick up those, you know, responsible variables and do a multivariate regression. And then, pinpoint, look, because of this cut in 2007, the volatility was so much. 2011, the downtrend, the low prices, there are so many prices there. So probably also the volatility is there, and the OPEC behavior is okay. The supply. So if you put in the small ones, I think the predictability.
I truly appreciate whatever you have told is absolutely right. But as you have seen that the mandate is very limited in this case. Now what you said is absolutely right, and one of our case actually delayed that case, which is a multivariate VAR model, which basically tried to establish the impact of oil price shock on Indian stock market. So that exactly what you are saying, that that follows that multivariate framework and all these things. Now apart from that, regarding the modeling of the oil price, as you know, it itself is a subject. And the models are still developing to capture, because nobody captured actually the oil price fluctuation. So these are, in terms of those complex models, these are a very base models.
My point was, if you develop this model,
Well, as I told, the time is a major problem. The entire course delivery is 2.5 months. I totally agree with you. But even with that kind of model, at it has the forecasting performance says that it is doing reasonably well. But as you told, that the spikes, which is sometimes called that outlier, suddenly there is a jump. So there are again a model called jump and diffusion methods, which generally works well in this kind of oil price modeling. This is just an experiment to say that how that that model, which we have learned in the classroom, the applicability of the model in terms of their forecasting performance. But I totally agree with you that it's a very complex subject, and the model which is trying to capture the oil price volatility and price itself, there are many more complex models. For which, of course, had it been a university course, then maybe we can, even I also don't know many of them. But as I told, that in a 2.5 months time, it's big difficult. But I totally agree with you that those are the actual, you know, thing. But on the multivariate case, I think there is one case study which they are doing. Sorry, you are asking.
Yeah,
yeah.
Even question was on merchant power plant.
Yes.
Effect of merchant power. And the question you want to know about diverted oil. First of all, in power sector, oil didn't play a major role in the our base supply is 54% or 56%. Then comes hydro, nuclear, and now natural gas energy is picking up. So the question is merchant power. Merchant power plant has totally Sony here. I don't know whether you like it. He has totally agitated the power system, whether it is on grid management or battery problem of supply of power. It has become a totally tool of gaming. Totally tool of gaming. Let us not compare what is electricity and what is a food supply. A food supply or a furniture supply or water supply or edible oils. This is a totally different market. It can't be predicted as accurately as you are trying to put it, what other consumables are there. There are enormous variations, and the worst variation is the weather itself. It changes on hourly basis, it changes on daily basis. Weather prediction has become so good now. So it has improved a lot. So therefore, demand and supply here can be correlated with weather. And weather protection is fully dependent on electricity. Because it is all communication. The whole world has been changed by the advent of electricity. And now we are debating electricity. How are we going to make it predictable? What I want to tell here, to my mostly young generation here, and my some of the thought process, and I have been in power sector since 1971. See, power, as I told, is a different body. Gardner formula was the best formula to manage the Indian power sector. To manage the Indian power sector, I quote it, underline it, and make it quote. We abolished it. For which politics are good, bureaucrats are responsible, technocrats are responsible, and above all, the private players are responsible. And one by one, whoever has indicated this formula is suffering. It was clearly established when NTPC was being set up, that 85% of the power, there have to be a permanent operator. So that you can design the systems, the wires, transmission line, distribution line, other facilities. And there are different pairs of 15% was to take care of the weather variation or any category. Suppose a big overwhelming game going on in Delhi, that 15% can be harnessed. For that, plastic mechanism can be designed. So that 15% included merchant concept, I see as it because of merchant power. 15% is variable available, and you can manage the system and you can manage here and there. And it all depends. If suppose Delhi and Madam said that power requirement changes from 1500 megawatt to 6000 megawatt, it is predicted to happen. It will happen, it may happen on a day, it may happen next day. System has its own problem, its requirement is less, it is vulnerable, its requirement is more, it is vulnerable. So therefore, if you have established a system for 100% and 85% uptake is taken, you can always take that power somewhere else and all that. But it has become, the merchant plant has become an absolutely game. People are setting up 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 megawatt power plant and they say, it is my merchant plant. I will sell it to Mumbai or Kerala or Bihar, depending upon what the load comes up. Who will build the transmission system? How the load dispatch center is going to manage? How are you going to manage on every day-to-day basis? So my request to all of you is that first of all, let us put our data together, and especially the issues like MPI, IIT, IIMs, that this method of merchant systems, somewhere some containment should be there, that if you are setting up such a set power project, 85% you have to tie up your permanent customers, 15% is only available, whatever size you set up. These are totally integrated and make fragile the whole process. The other important aspect is, I was discussing with my colleague, is the development of non-conventional energy systems. Look at solar, look at wind. Solar is maximum during the daytime, goes up, wind picks up in the night. There is a huge demand to integrate non-conventional energy with conventional energy, whether thermal, hydro, gas, or even for a place like Gurgaon, we can set up DG sets, huge DG sets, and connect with non-conventional energy resources. We can buy power from Rajasthan or Gujarat. That will be far, far cheaper than burning our diesel oil, etc. So it is completely a different complex phenomenon. What we have tried to do in the Act 2003, and in fact I have been a donor of this, and I am a donor even today also I am a donor, that somehow we are trying to confuse with a common commodity or gold price or oil price. Advent of shale gas is going to reduce the coal price. And coal is going to be a fuel of past if shale gas comes. So what is going to happen? Those who have set up coal-based power plants, they are not going to be easily give up. They will again try to influence the system and see to it that the prices are linked to the coal at which they are mining of. So these bottles and all that, whatever is there, we can have a debate, one day debate. Kindly, MDI can organize all some IAPNs, IAMs and all that. Let us have a 2-3 day debate as to how the power sector is suffering, what are the technical issues, commercial issues, administrative issues, and create a platform which can address the problem of the power sector. The basic problem is you and I, as a consumer, we are not getting power. People sitting in Delhi may get power, what about the village? The problem is people are not getting drinking water. See, the worst thing is that lifestyle is changing. Everyone wants to have everything different now. Computer, iPad. One iPad consumes as much power as it frees consumes. I think you must be knowing it. It is that one. So let us discuss this, but today's topic is good.
Yeah, sir, if I in my observation, as I'm 100% agree with you, but again the focus of this particular presentation is very, very limited.
as you told, I am totally agreed that Indian power, we all know that, and you are the practitioners in the Indian power sector, knows that how the sector is operating. So there are so many issues in the, as you told, administrative, policy, regulatory, many issues. We call power sector as a popular, is a, you know, interesting area of how political economy works. And we know that. So whatever you told as a development of the power sector, and there are issues, and you know, fuel substitutability, the choice of fuel, coal versus renewables versus gas versus etc. Well, that is, as we told, as you know, that is a very broader perspective of the power sector development, which I totally agree with you. I totally appreciate your views, and people like you who are spending almost your lifetime in the sector is, of course, is a, the, your views are more valuable. But as I told, that we have a very limited mandate. We are just forecasting is the objective. But of course, we should match it with the demand side. There is no doubt about that. But well, one can do that. But
forecasting is good. But if people are setting up huge merchant power plant, and system is not
defined. Definitely, I totally.
I think this is a very serious system. Whatever modeling you do and all that, if the tool is not
sufficient. I totally.
This just a month before, yeah. Or even today. Electricity in Tamil Nadu and in whole of southern India is being sold at 12 rupees a unit because there is no transmission system to carry power from eastern and western region to southern region. Whereas here you are stopping your power plants. There are many sectoral issues and our planning is there.
I totally.
I
would like to add one thing here. We have discussed in Delhi about the power situation. I feel one of the reasons for the improvement of Delhi power situation is because we use sustainable energy. If we plan something without analytics, we may end up in the case. These are the base. We may not be using those formulas or other things, but analytics is must. If we talk that the chaos is something and analytics is some more, first we need analytics. That only we can solve the problem. Because it's not because of any other reason, purely because of non-availability of analytics. We have talked about generation, but we are not talking about transmission, and it's a mistake of the forecasting. Incomplete forecasting. So forecasting is must and foremost. Due importance should be there. This only can solve our problems.
There is a result, but there is no
data description, empirical analysis, and with